Good morning, everyone. The message will be going live in about 2 minutes' time. So just refresh your page, prepare your hearts and your minds to hear God's word this morning, and we'll be going live in 2 minutes' time. Thank you. Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome this morning to our service online. My name is Matt, and I'm one of the ministers at K Street Baptist Church, and it's just fantastic to be able to come and share God's word with you this morning. I want to say, before we pray together, just a massive thank you to all those involved in the service this morning, putting the service together. Each contribution was unique and wonderful, and so proud of you all. So thank you so much for that really uplifting, encouraging service. Before I pray, I wanted, friends, to share some news with you. For a while as a church, we've been praying for James and Sally and their little boy, Zach, who has been very poorly with cancer. And we know James, of course, because James for a while was part of our youth group here at K Street. He was in the youth group with Paul and Phil and Rob, and so really a part of our church family, and grew up at the church in Edgeside Baptist as well. So we have a link with James and his family for many years, and we've been praying for them along with many other churches for them and for their son Zach, who was just 4 years of age. Sadly, this past week, Zach succumbed to the cancer and is now with Jesus. And I wanted to share that with you this morning, just in case you hadn't heard that news through the various prayer meetings and through the various social media posts, outlets, etc. But I ask you to remember James and Sally in your prayers at this time of unbelievable loss. 4 years of age. All the dreams that he had and they had for him will never be fulfilled. And they have to navigate their way through life without him. I cannot begin to imagine the pain that they're going through right now. Please remember too, Zach's older brother, Caleb, as he comes to terms, oh my gosh, how'd you come to terms with that? The loss of his brother. Remember Chris and Jill, James's parents, and Sally's family as well. And before I pray, can I ask you to remember the church family at Edgeside? Jill and Chris were a major part of that church family there, and that will have a huge impact on them. And we pray too for Glenn as he seeks to lead that fellowship at this desperately difficult time. So friends, would you bow your heads with me? Let's pray. Let's commend them to God and to his mercy. Lord Jesus, words fail us at a time like this. It's so difficult, God, to articulate what we want to say. But Father, we pray for James. We pray for Sally. We pray for Caleb and the wider family, that God, your presence, your comfort, your peace will be all sufficient for them right now. In their pain, in their loss, in the questions that they feel and the questions that they have. Father, help them each day to know that you are with them. And Father, we pray for Glenn as he tries to lead a church family that will be hurting and feeling this loss very keenly right now. God, we pray that you would give to Glenn strength and wisdom, courage and words of sensitivity that bring hope and life. And Father, we ask for Jill and Chris that, again, they might know a special touch from heaven at this time. Father, thank you that Zach is now with you, which is the only, Lord, hope that we can take from this, because we have a hope in the gospel. If there's any comfort, know that Jesus, you are holding him. But for James and Sally, Father, again, we pray for them that you might help them, Lord, each day to put one foot in front of the other and trust you. God, we commend them to you as a family. We pray for them in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Amen. Friends, it seems strange talking about good news when I've just shared something like that, because that's what our series has been. It's been a series on the good news of the gospel. And throughout these past 7 weeks, we've been talking about how Jesus demonstrated it, how Jesus lived it, how Jesus calls us to demonstrate it and live it. And this morning, we draw this present series to a close. And we've just heard those two readings. And a big thank you to Timothy and Stephen for reading those for us from Matthew's Gospel, chapter 28. And Acts chapter 1. But I want to focus my thoughts primarily on our Matthew reading. Jesus had a parting moment with his disciples. It was not a farewell, just a temporary goodbye. And ultimately, when Jesus returned, they would be with him forever. Parting words are often chosen very carefully. You want to get it right. You want to say something of profound importance. Jesus's parting shot went something like this: go and make disciples of all nations. That was his final verbal legacy before his ascension. And I find it remarkable that he took 12 ordinary people with different experiences, personalities and talents, and shaped them, bar one, to become foundational figures in the early church. And I'm absolutely convinced that when they set out on that journey to follow him, they had no idea where that journey would lead or how long it would last. But still, they followed. Moments before his ascension, Jesus gave his disciples their final instructions. It's a summary of all Jesus had taught them about being his disciples. Not merely a summary, but also their mandate for becoming effective disciples. That word mandate means a command from a higher authority. And I want us to consider this mandate together. But before I do, it's important for us to know that Jesus said in the verse before the verses we heard from Stephen and Timothy this morning, that all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. There is no higher mandate, no greater authority in heaven or earth than the authority of Jesus Christ. The Holy One will determine the destiny of every single person in the world, has commanded us to go and speak and act in His name. He is the authority under which life, God's new life, can begin to flourish. Philippians 2 tells us that Jesus has been given the name which is above every name, and at the name of Jesus every knee shall bow. What a high honour to be called His ambassadors, and we go in His authority. So let's consider this mandate together. Three areas that I want to consider. The first is the purpose of our mandate. Let's refresh our memories of the verses that were read to us earlier. Therefore, so we stand in that authority, therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. Deep in every authentic Christian, there is an awareness that we are on this planet for a purpose greater than having a career, paying bills, loving our families, and fulfilling our roles as citizens. And that's because there is one supreme role that we can only fulfill whilst we're here on earth that will have eternal consequences. In the short term that God has given us here on earth, we can make an impact that will outlast us here on earth, indeed that will last for eternity. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, baptizing them, teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you. The construction of this sentence shows that Jesus was placing the emphasis on his strategy to make disciples. This was their primary task: go and make disciples. Everything else was subordinate. Everything else was secondary. This was their primary task. Notice what is not mentioned: building churches, cathedrals. It's not mentioned. Appointing bishops or regional ministers. Not mentioned. Founding theological colleges, missionary societies, charitable institutions. It's not mentioned. Now, these things are useful. Some may even be essential to a mission infrastructure, but only insofar as they contribute to this ultimate objective, this priority, this strategy, making disciples who will then make disciples themselves. And that is a key phrase this morning: making disciples who will then make disciples themselves. If these institutions, these buildings, these activities do not enable us, do not equip us to be better, more effective followers of Jesus Christ, then they become a luxury. They become superfluous. Everything we do should be shaped by this great commission of Jesus. And it's so important, friends, that we understand this morning that the commission that we have, this mandate in front of us, is about much more than telling people about Jesus or leading someone to faith in Christ, which is absolutely fantastic. It's about entering into the community of God's people, where friends are helped to learn, grow, develop, and become more like Jesus so they can fulfill that call to serve him. Things like Alpha is fantastic, and it's wonderful to hear all those testimonies about Alpha and how Alpha has impacted their lives. Absolutely brilliant. But Alpha is a means to an end. It's not an end in itself. It's this whole thing of disciples making disciples. This commission reminds us what we are here for. It reminds us what the church is here for. This should be central to everything we do at K Street Baptist. All our activities, all our energies, all our time, all our discussions, all our expenditure should be evaluated by this simple criteria. Does it assist in fulfilling this mandate given to us by Jesus? And during this lockdown period and going forward out of lockdown, these questions, these debates, these discussions are absolutely crucial, because it gives us an opportunity to review, to rethink, to reevaluate, and think to ourselves, are we fulfilling this mandate? Are we fulfilling this great commission? Johnny mentioned last week, or the week before, I believe it was, about our mission statement, the up, in, and the out. Following Jesus personally, following Jesus together, following Jesus everywhere. The up, our relationship with God. The in, the relationship with each other. And then the out, which is this. It's this. It's the Great Commission. It's go and make disciples. And I think if we're honest, perhaps as a church, we've probably spent more of our time on the up and the in and less on the out. And we need to have all three working effectively in order to be the church that God is calling us to be. As Archbishop William Temple said in, 1945, a long time ago, the church is the only society on earth that exists for the benefit of its non-members. If we forget this, if we neglect this, if we ignore this, we lose our mandate and we lose God's blessing and favour. In our other reading today from Acts 1:8, Jesus added, "You will be my witnesses." See, it's no coincidence. There we go, just before his ascension, saying exactly the same thing. That's all that Jesus ever calls us to be. His witnesses, to tell what Jesus Christ has done in history, to tell what Jesus has done in our lives, the basis of our mandate, the purpose of our mandate. Go and make disciples. Making disciples who then make disciples. Second point, the extent of our mandate. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations. All nations, which in the Greek means all people groups. We have a worldwide mandate. It's for everyone, all time. It's a timeless mandate. We have a strategic mandate from Acts chapter 1 also. We start at home in our own Jerusalem before we attempt to reach Judea or Samaria, let alone the ends of the earth. Our mandate is to share the love of Jesus with those we live with, those that we know. But how on earth could 11 disciples reach the whole world through such a strategy? Let's start again with one typical believer. Just go with me on this. Let's think about our very own Johnny. And because Johnny is not only committed to being a disciple, he is committed to making disciples. And what he does, largely unnoticed, is make friends with unbelievers. He takes an interest in their lives. He demonstrates authenticity, integrity, compassion, empathy, and the self-giving love of Jesus overflows from his life. He models it and people see it. They see it. They're attracted to it. And because they are open and they listen, Johnny takes the opportunity to tell them about what Jesus has and is doing in his life. When one of them trusts in Christ, Johnny spends time with them to show them how to pray, how to read the Bible, how to grow, how to know God better, and how to tell others about what God has done for them also. Let's assume that Johnny gets to share his faith with one person just once a week. And let's assume that in 6 months, he sees just one person trust in Christ. Let's call him Matt. All right? Let's call him Matt. But here's the key. Instead of simply inviting Matt to church and perhaps to join his small group, Johnny explains to Matt how he can be an effective disciple of Jesus. So during the second period, the second 6 months of that first year, Johnny and Matt make friends with unbelievers and aim to talk to Jesus to someone just once a week. And each have the joy of seeing one person become a Christian in the next 6 months. So at the end of that first year, four disciples. Doesn't sound very many, but something radical is happening in Johnny's small group.
If those four disciples pass on what they know, which may not be much, but each sees one person trust in Christ in the next 6 months and disciples them to reproduce themselves in the same way, at the end of year two, there will be 16 disciples. At the end of year three, 64. At the end of year four, 256. Using this strategy and response rate, our little small band of disciples is doubling every 6 months. And friends, I've worked this out as well. Within 15 years, over 1 billion people will have been reached. Over 1 billion people within 15 years. It's the difference between just filling our pews on a Sunday morning and training disciples. If we were the only Christians in the whole world using this strategy, taking Jesus' mandate seriously, we alone could see the world transformed for Jesus Christ, one life at a time. Jesus knew what he was talking about. He was commissioning a movement that was both radical and revolutionary, but using a strategy that is both simple and practical, becoming effective disciples in the life of a few friends and family. Investing our lives in a few people who in turn will invest their lives in others and letting God do the rest. It's the whole process of multiplication. It's one life at a time. It's a mindset. It's changing a culture. It's making disciples who make disciples. And you may say to me, and I say it to myself as I was thinking about this, well, we've not seen that happen in the last 2,000 years. No, we haven't. And why haven't we? Why haven't we? Because I believe that we need a whole culture shift, a mind shift, a whole attitude change towards discipleship and what effective discipleship is. It's me and you connecting in with those that we love and care for and reach out into our community one life at a time. And if we all had that mindset, if we all did it, then we would see this world change for Jesus Christ. Absolutely believe it. It's unequivocal. It's been amazing during this time of lockdown to see people reaching out to their neighbours, their friends, and being the church without walls, a phrase that we coined many, many years ago, or should I say Roy Searle coined for us at a church weekend away. What does it mean for us to be a church without walls? Friends, it's the up, in and the out. But it's the out that we need to give more attention to, one life at a time. Sometimes when we think about how big this world is, how many millions of people are in this world, we think it's too big for us. No, change the mindset. Think one life at a time. One life, effective disciples making disciples who then make disciples themselves. And it processes through that way. Friends, we can do this. We can absolutely do this because we have Jesus with us. It starts in Jerusalem, then Judea, then Samaria, then to the ends of the earth. It cannot be suppressed and it has not been superseded. And this leads me on to my final point, which I guess is the most important point of all. And that is Matthew 28:20. And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age. Wow, what a promise. I can't do this in my strength. You can't do it in your strength, but we can do it in his strength. And that same power, you remember I talked about this last week, that same power that raised Jesus from the dead is the same power that resides and lives and equips us day by day. The passage that the boys read to us earlier says, you will receive power. You will receive power when my spirit comes upon you. So as we connect with our friends and our families and we disciple one life at a time, it's not us doing that. Yes, God uses our personality, uses our gifts, and we're a vehicle of his blessing, but it's ultimately God through his spirit who does it. You are not alone. We do not do this alone. And think about that remarkable promise that Jesus says, I am with you. Perhaps Matthew is kind of clear in that he wants us to see the promise of the very first chapter, Matthew chapter 1, Emmanuel, God with us. In his mind, he's making a deliberate connection there and saying loud and clear, Jesus is the Emmanuel, the one in whom God is with us. Now, he declares that he himself is with them always. How they needed to hear those words, that Jesus is with them. Hear those words this morning for you, friends. I'm praying those words for James and Sally this morning. I'm praying those words for Jill and Chris. I'm praying those words for the church family at Edgeside. I'm praying those words for Joyce, who's in hospital at the moment. I'm praying those words for Gordon, who was taken back into hospital last night. And I will be with you to the very end of the age. Friends, this Jesus is with us. He walks with us. He cries with us. He holds us when we need to be held. We go in his name. And so just as the disciples, when they gather that mountaintop in Galilee, how they needed to hear those words, well, how we need to hear those words this morning. Still in lockdown, still going stir crazy, still wanting to get out and meet our friends and our family, still wanting life to return to some kind of normal, whatever new normal will look like. But it still seems such a long way off. Jesus says, I am with you until the very end of the age. And thinking about it, it's not so much that he goes with us. It's rather that we go with him. We go with him. Jesus is not like the general waving his troops off as they go into battle, as he orchestrates things at HQ. Jesus goes with us. Luke makes that clear in his foreword to the Acts of the Apostles. He begins with this introduction. In my former book, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus began to do and to teach until the day he was taken up to heaven. He commands and we obey. He leads and we follow. He goes with us. We go with him into whatever day we face. This is our mandate, friends. This is our mandate. We have a purpose. The gospel is for everyone, and we have the presence and the power of Jesus with us every day. Let's be disciples who make disciples and see this world change for Jesus, one life at a time. Let's just have a moment of quiet as we pray and as we consider that. Think about Jesus' words, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me, and we go in that authority. Think about the same power that raised Jesus from the dead is the power that's living in you right now. Think about those friends and those families that you can make connections with. Pray that God will open up conversations and opportunities. Pray that God will give you the words to speak into their hearts and their lives. Pray that you will see the joy of people responding to the Lord Jesus Christ and then going on to make disciples themselves. Father, we thank you. We thank you, Lord, that we are not alone, that you are with us until the very end of the age. Lord, you have given us this commission, you have given us this mandate, and we don't do it on our own. Father, when we're feeling discouraged, when we're feeling overwhelmed, when we feel like we can't do it, when we're afraid, God, would you fill us with your authority, with your power, with your belief, with your affirmation? and know that we can make a difference in your name. Lord, change our mindset from just filling our churches so that we can add up our numbers every year to filling our churches with people who are disciples on fire for Jesus, wanting to share his name with everyone that we meet. Father, thank you for your word to us this morning. Father, I pray that these won't just be nice words, God, that we hear, but Lord, that we would take these words to our heart and live them and breathe them, God, for you. And I pray this in Jesus' precious name and for the extension of his kingdom in this community, in this place. Amen. Amen. Amen, friends. It's just been great to share with you this morning. And before I go, I wanted to share some news with you, some really important news about someone who means the world to us as a church. And we've seen her in action this morning with the family time. And that's our own Jess Goldie, our family and children's worker. Just a few weeks ago now, as a leadership, we received this letter from Jess, and I'll read the letter to you, and then I'll make a few comments after that. So Jess writes, "Dear friends, I hope you're all keeping well. I've got some news to share, which will be a surprise to some of you, and to others, maybe not. Some of you will be aware that for the last year or so, I've been feeling a bit restless, and as a result, I started looking into various options for returning to study. My initial intention was to undertake a program of study which could fit around my role at K Street, but by last September, it became clear that no such option existed. After much prayer and consideration, I started to push some other doors, asking God to open the right one. Last week, which would have been a couple of weeks ago, one such door opened, as it were, and as a result, from September, I'll be returning to full-time study on a BSc adult nursing course. This means that I won't be able to continue as K Street's family and children's worker beyond the end of August. This is not an easy decision, as I absolutely love my role at K Street, but I can't ignore the feeling of being prodded in this direction. Chris, Ernie and I absolutely feel that K Street is our home and it isn't our intention to leave the church. I would like to continue as an active member, and although I will initially need to step back whilst I get to grips with this huge change, I am as excited as ever about what God has in store for K Street, and I don't want to miss it. Blessings, Jess." Now, I have some comments to make on this letter that we received. First of all, when we received this news, when Johnny and I received this news and the deacons received this news, there was a sense of sadness. Jess is a fantastic family and children's worker. Let me just put that out there right now. She is fantastic at what she does. And I've had a number of people comment to me just how you see those true gifts come through when she's been doing the family time every week. The way that she addresses the children, almost as if they were there in the room with her. She's a natural. She exudes that. Just that warmth and that love and that care for the children and the families that she's talking to. So she is a fantastic family and children's worker. But more than that, she is a fantastic person. She is a caring, loving mother, wife, friend to so many. She is a fantastic woman of God. So that's why when we received this news, there was a sense of sadness. But there was also a sense of optimism, because we were thrilled by that last paragraph when she said that they absolutely feel that K Street is their home. They're not going anywhere. They're still going to be involved, and they don't want to miss out on what God is going to do through the K Street family. And so we were thrilled that Jess and Chris and Ernie are still going to be a part of our fellowship at K Street going forward. And I also want to say this, and I'm going to really encourage you to do this, please. In the midst of you receiving this news, and you're hearing it for the first time, so I appreciate there will be a sense of shock and sadness. But as you process this, and as you think about this, this is a fantastic opportunity for Jess. It's a wonderful opportunity for her. And let's pray for her. Let's support her and encourage her and her little family. And I do want you this week, I encourage you to message her, speak to her. And Jess has even said that to me. If you want to find out more, if you want to find out more about this journey that she's on, the heart, why she feels God's calling in her into nursing, please contact her. She will be only too willing to talk to you about it. So I think we have a responsibility as a church to get alongside her, to pray and support and encourage her and them as they navigate this new role together. So a mixture of emotions and feelings that I feel right now, and I'm sure that you're feeling right now as well. And one last thing before I pray for them as a family. Please pray for us as a leadership here, as we think and reflect and consider this news and what this means for us as a church family going forward. Please pray for wisdom. Please pray that God would lead and guide us so we will know what to do going forward. But for now, let's honour Jess and give thanks to God for all that she has done, all that she is doing, and all that she will continue to do in our midst, albeit in a slightly different role. So let's have a moment of quiet and remember Jess together. Lord Jesus, we thank you for Jess, for all that she means to us, for the way that she loves you and serves you, and for the way that she has impacted our church family over these past 3 years. God, she is a fantastic woman of God, and we thank you for her commitment, for her gifts, for her passion, but also for her character, Lord, for the way that she cares, for the way that she draws alongside families, the way that she just so easily, it's almost like you're inviting your best friend round for tea, the way that she can just make you feel so comfortable in her presence. Thank you for that relationship, Lord, that she has built with the families at K Street and beyond. And Lord, we will miss her in that role. And we give you our thanks and praise. And Father, as she begins this new phase in her life and her ministry, as she takes this course of studying to be a nurse, Father, would you lead and guide her? Lord, thank you for the, in one sense, the promise that we've heard this morning, that you are with us until the very end of the age. Father, thank you that you will be with her. You already know, Lord, what this course is going to be like. You already know what's going to happen. You've prepared the way. Lord, may she trust in you, hold your hand, and walk beside you every step of the way. Father, we bless you too for Chris and for Ernie. God, we thank you for them. We thank you for all that they've brought into our lives. Oh, we thank you for Chris, God. We thank you for his love for his family. Lord, we thank you for his friendship. And we pray that you would draw him closer to yourself. And for little Ernie, Lord, thank you for him. What a bundle of fun and joy he is. And Lord, I ask that in the fullness of time, Lord, he will grow into be a real man of God for you. So Father, hold this family, lead them and guide them. And we thank you for them in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Amen. So friends, it's been great being with you this morning and sharing with you. Go in the name of the Lord, the name of the Lord that is powerful and will be with you until the very end of the age. And God bless you and stay safe. And I'll see you all again soon. God bless.